And so you see the resurrection that Christians all over the world celebrate yearly. Like an annual event. Like an anniversary of Christ's resurrection. But what is important, the area we must look right now is resurrection has significance. And this area has generally been overlooked by the Christian world, by believers, by brethren. And we must not look as good believers, as faithful brethren, as committed children of God. The significance of Easter must not be overlooked, but rather must be cherished. For we cannot observe Easter in a manner pleasing unto God without reflecting on the significance. Is it the significance that gives credence to Easter proper? That's why the first Bible lesson is saying that the children of Israel, because they were ignorant of God's righteousness, they went ahead establishing their own form of righteousness. They went on their own, each of them claiming self-righteousness, each of them establishing a way or a form of righteousness. But unknown to them that the righteousness of resurrection, the righteousness of Christ, is based on faith.
Hallelujah.
And so, whatsoever form of righteousness that anyone is observing or practicing or claiming, if it is not built on these three principles, which constitute the significance of a resurrection and indeed Easter, such a person will have to have a day. And the three are love, faith, and hope. Love, faith, and hope. Spreading it beyond history, then you will have forgiveness and mercy. You have forgiveness and mercy. Spreading it beyond itself. And so, beloved Christian brethren, the significance of Christ's resurrection is, first of all, what? Victory. It shows the supremacy of our Lord Jesus Christ, who of all emerged victoriously. He exercised supremacy over life, supremacy over death. Supremacy over life and over death. And surrendering his life as a living sacrifice was as a result of love. The result of love is a result of mercy. And because he also hoped, Christ had this hope in him, that mankind, having been saved or redeemed by his blood, will not live the old pattern life, but will live a new life in the new world after his death. And so everyone who enjoyed the redemption, everyone was saved by the grace through Christ, must have faith in Christ, must have hope in Christ, must love even as Christ loved us. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And so, beloved Christian brethren, one who claims to be a Christian but then does not have love, even for one another, it's not reflecting on the Easter proper. It's not reflecting on Christ's death. It's not reflecting on Christ's resurrection. Certainly not. To such a person, is that they observe the true righteousness, and that is faith. That is love. That is hope. Christians must have hope. It is hope that sustains us. And that was why the word of God said, even when situation has so torn so bad that you have to cry, do not cry as those without hope. Christians have hope. What keeps the Christian going is hope. What keeps you and I moving is hope. If we do not have hope, then we will abandon the faith. Because sometimes problem comes quite very heavy. Very heavy, seeing as if we can't get it. But we hope we pass on. We hope we continue to forge ahead. And because hope makes you ashamed. And so you must have hope. Because Christ, at the point of the passion, when he has surrendered himself to be executed, to be crucified, to be tortured to death, he gave them a hint of hope. He said to them, I am going to Jerusalem. There I will be tortured. I will be killed. I will be put down deep the earth. I will be there. But on the third day, I shall come and unite with you. Now, that was hope. He gave them that impression. He gave them that information to keep their hope alive. And they held up to that hope. And so a good Christian must make sure at all times you have hope, no matter what it is. We have told you that there is no situation that is not under control. The Father controls all situations. You don't need to doubt God. Don't allow situation to put you in a corner. Don't allow yourself to be boxed to a corner where you need to doubt, where you need to question the capacity of the Holy Spirit. His ability, don't avoid it. Resist that temptation. Resist it. For have hope. Have faith. Believe. And so, dear Christian brethren, it is important that as Christians, as lovers of God, as faithful children of God, we must not establish self-righteousness. We must not acclaim any form of righteousness that is not with faith. Be proud of your faith. Be proud of the love. You can boast of your love. And there is no love for God if you do not have love for one another. The love for God is an extension of loving one another. In fact, how much you love the Father will be shown by how the devil. And that was why Christ asked Peter, Simon Peter, love it down me, and he said, death is a thing by sheep. So, when you claim to love God, you must love the children of God. Your love for God will be measured by how much you have love for your fellow brethren. This is true righteousness, not self-acclaimed righteousness. Not self established righteousness. Righteousness established by the word of God. Righteousness established by the faith in Christ. Righteousness built on the death and resurrection. The foundation of the whole suffering of Christ was love. Because he loved mankind beyond measure. And so he take upon himself the sin of mankind. That was love. And so this love is meant to be practiced. It's meant to be taught in the churches. And it's meant to be practiced by Christians. Because when Christians exercise the true love, the new heaven and the new earth, where it dwells righteousness. That righteousness is love. That righteousness is faith. That righteousness is hope. That righteousness is forgiveness. That righteousness is mercy. A new heaven and a new earth, where it dwells righteousness. Not self-acclaimed righteousness, not self-established righteousness, but righteousness based on the faith in Christ. We must imitate Christ.
Read the first Bible lesson.
Yes. Yes.
Our witness is taken from the book of Romans, chapter 10, verse 6 and 7.
That is pleasing unto God, for which it will be counted as righteousness. And so, doubting must be completely out of it. Unnecessary questioning must be completely out of it. Don't ask questions based on ignorance. Don't conceive things in your heart. For the heart of man always thinks evil. Imagine evil things. Believe Christ actually resurrected. Believe Christ is the way, He is the life, He is the truth. He is the foundation of all things, the beginning and the end, the doctor and finisher of our faith. The end of all laws. And that law is that we love one another because He died for one another. Yes?
So, who shall ascend into the deep? That is, to bring up Christ again from the dead, to the name of our Lord Jesus.
Amen. Read Hebrews 11, verse 6.
Our former witness,
still on faith,
is taken from the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, verse 6. But without faith, it is impossible to please Him. For he that cometh to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen. Pray, happy church. For anyone who doubts resurrection, anyone who imagines the possibility of resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ and not be saved with pleasing God. Such imagination is alien to faith, is alien to Christ's faith, and must not be conceived. But rather, we must be committed to be imitators of Christ, practitioners of His works. For whosoever cometh unto God must believe that He is, for without faith nobody can please Him. And so, as many that call upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ must believe that Christ actually resurrected, and if you so believe, you must hold on to the pillars of resurrection, the principles of resurrection, the significance of resurrection proper, and hold on to what He died for. He died for mankind, He didn't die for goats, He didn't die for fishes, He didn't die for animals, He died for mankind, for you and I, that we live in unity, that we forgive one another, that we be merciful to one another, that we cherish each other, that we prefer one another, that we be kindly affectionate one to another. And all of these, and many more, as you can see in the scripture, we must continue to hold on these things and practice them. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Pray after church. Yeah, read the second Bible lesson. Yes. There seems to be so many churches in the world, and we have observed that it seems to us that the more churches we have, the more the world becomes problematic. Because the churches are not impacting the true knowledge of Christ. The churches are not teaching the true foundation of Christ. The churches are not holding on to the spirit of our Lord Jesus Christ. And as long as this continues, you see we have churches all over the world, more problems. But brethren, let us not be like them. Let us be Christians with difference. Christians who are committed, and that's why we are quite practical. We must practicalize the teachings of the Holy Spirit. Practicalize the teachings of our Lord Jesus Christ, who made himself a living sacrifice. That the second Bible lesson is saying that Christ made himself a living sacrifice to save man, and that it is his desire that men must walk, children of God must walk in accordance to his teachings and in line with his will. You must not do things your own way. Do it in Christ's way. Do it in a manner that will be pleasing unto him who made himself a living sacrifice. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Read Matthew 5, verse 48.
The former witness is taken from St. Matthew, Gospel, chapter 5, verse 48.
Yes.
St. Matthew, Gospel, chapter 5, verse 48. Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father.
Be therefore perfect, even as our Father. Who is our Father? Our Father is our Lord Jesus Christ. The Father of Christian faith is Christ. He is the Father of Christian faith. He is a perfect master. And everyone who is a follower of Christ will be perfect. Must be perfect. Read Luke 6. 35 and 36. And so, parents must be committed to training the mind of the children. Train the mind of the children. Today is Children's Day. Train their mind to fear God, to fear God, and live in a world like they are living with brothers and sisters. For we are all brethren. Train the children not to see anyone as an enemy, but to see all as brothers and sisters, as brethren. Train the children to fear God. Train their mind to reverence God, to worship Him. Train the mind of the children to love one another. Tell them whatever anybody may do unto them, they should forgive and let go. So, a seed of forgiveness in their lives. And no matter what, they should be ready to let go, to forgive. For these are the attributes of Christ, who have made himself a living sacrifice. Without love, he will not work. Tell them in all situations they should have hope. Even when things seem very complex, tell them not to give up their hope in God. Tell them to hold on to their hope. Train their mind. For when the Bible says, train the children in the ways of God, so that when they grow up, they shall not depart. It's about training them on principles, godly principles. Train them on fundamentals, what matters. Train them on the fear of God. Train them to have hope that they will always come out of that difficult situation. That situation that seems hopeless, they will come out of it. Tell them to have hope, to believe, to be faithful, to hold on to God, to trust God, to depend. It makes But also train your mind. Count on your father. Rely, depend. Surrender completely. Have hope. Yes.
From verse 45 to 46.
I did not say that.
45 to 36. But not ye enemies.
But not ye the enemies. Not your enemies. There are enemies everywhere. If you do not decide in your hearts consciously to love the enemies, you are going to live in this world and you put yourself in prison. Because the moment you are in hatred, the moment you are in enemies, you have gone inside spiritual imprisonment. You won't be free. The world is so choked up with evil men and women. Everywhere you talk to, they are there. Everywhere you talk to. So you must know that living in enmity with anybody will not help you, because you will be so much. You won't like yourself. First, you will be living in tears. Because the more enemies you have, the more fearful you become. Yes. The more enemies. Why do you think, or why are the politicians? Where are those who have looted the common cause of the people? Why are those occupying sensitive positions to manage the resources of the people living in fear? It's because they know that they are not doing what is right. They have offended the people by not managing the resources for the common good. But have truly and honestly embezzled all the funds to themselves. They have amassed their wealth to themselves and their families, and they know that they are guilty. They live in fear. They go with escorts. They go with escorts. Armed men following them left and right. And then even when they are going about the police, their wives who are aware of how much they have cheated the people, he said, my dear, I think you should leave this police up. This police is a compromise. Go and carry army. They can be following you. Leave this police. Because the wife knows to what extent the husband have cheated the people. And the wife begins to have fear. If they kill my husband now, this money, this thing will be their job. So I have to bring idea to protect him. He said, bring army, bring soldier. Make me protect you. Hallelujah.
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 Then it will be
better, I say, for where? So, you know, We all help each other to grow. When you are weak, oftentimes you realize that you cannot stand up on your own. You need to hold something, or if anybody near you, you have to hold that person to stand. That is how life is. Everybody in this world naturally are weak, one way or the other. Weakness varies. Everybody around God is saying strength. And so the life, the way it's planned, originally according to the vision of the creator of this earth, is that you hold me to stand, I hold you to stand. You help me to grow, I help the other person to grow. What does that mean? You feed from somebody. There is no millionaire that was born millionaire.
At all.
In fact, the most successful ones are those who work under successful men. The most successful people are those who are privileged to work under successful men. And then from there they go. So you help people to grow. This world is not meant to be the way it is. Live peacefully. Live a just life. Be fair to all. Be equitable to all. Be nice. Be nice. Share what you have. That is the love that Christ represents. Be merciful. Even to those who have offended you. Be merciful. Don't harden your heart because someone has offended you. For we all offended God, offended Christ, yet we did not harden his hearts. When someone offended you, and the person realizes himself, and say, my God, I'm sorry. Accept it. Let it not be too heavy in your mouth to say you are sorry. Let it not be too heavy. The lightest thing that you give in every believer's heart and will not proceed out of mouth is that you are sorry. When you say sorry, say it with sincerity and honesty. Let it come from your heart. Anyone who has the fear of God will own up and apologize from the heart. With the fear of God, knowing that whatsoever thing you do it unto the Lord. And that's why the Bible says, God, in the things you do, in everything, do not do it as if it's unto men. Any good thing you do is unto God. Any bad you do is against God. And so as you apologize to the person who directly felt the heat or who directly felt the impact of the error or mistake that you have done, that person is a representative of God. If you apologize sincerely from your heart, you have apologized to God. And if the person says it's also, it's all right, God has also forgiven you. So it is important that we make peace with fellow men, we reconcile with fellow men before approaching God. Because every act that is wrong on earth is directly impacting, whether negatively or positively, on the other person. And you must be quick to realize yourself, apologize much. And most sincerely. That's why the word of God says, when you want to pay your tithes, no matter how many millions you have to pay, God is not interested. First, he's interested that you save your soul. And how do you save your soul? It's to live in peace with fellow men. It's to reconcile. And he said, don't pay the tithes. If you pay it, you are waste. You waste it. Because nothing will come to you, no blessing. That's why the word of God specifically without missing words. He said, at that point you want to pay your life with your life. That there is a brother you offended. There is a brother, a sister who is not happy. He said, go back first. Some of us think that the father is very much interested in money. Even when you are praying, you will drop your head in the altar and you want to pray that it will flash your mind. Because the spirit is wonderful. It will not flash you. You see a picture of that person you have offended. That person you have made to cry. The picture will flash. instead of you to leave at that point, to go and find a way to reconcile, you still go ahead because you think the money you want to pay will be able to assuage the mind of God or change anything. No. When God has spoken, He has spoken. All of these were lessons meant to teach us what Christ died for. He died for love. He died for forgiveness. He died for mercy. He died for unity. That all of us will be united, not only to the Father, but united within ourselves. And so everything that brings up His head to sincere that relationship between one another, between God and the children, we must watch the test. Yes.
But love ye your enemies and do good, and lend, hoping for nothing again, and your reward shall be great, and ye shall be the children of the highest, for He is kind unto thee, unthankful unto the evil. Be ye therefore merciful, as your Father also
is. Be ye therefore merciful. Do not harden your hearts. Do not say this thing you did, I will never forgive you. Be ye therefore merciful as your Father is merciful. Forgive, let go, count no offense against anyone. Let go. Yes. Amen. Three hearty church. Want to tell you something? Maybe if you learn these aspects, it will be easier. Because we want you to live according to the will of God. We want you to get the best of blessings. Anything that stands against our good health, against the grace of God upon our life, we will let that avoid it. And so it is on that basis that we want to tell you this. It is not a gospel that is meant to be repeated again and again, again and again. It is a gospel that flashes once in a while and you leave it to rest. Beloved Christian brethren, the reason why some men find it so difficult to let go, to offend them, the reason why it is so difficult in the heart of men to say, I have forgiven you, is because the offense is perceived to be so very painful and it touches the hearts. It touches the hearts. And one will say, for this thing you have done, heaven knows I will not deserve this. I have been very fair to you. But for you to do this, I will forgive you. And so, now no matter what you preach, because of the level of offense, the pains, is so difficult to let go. Now, hear this. Then you will know that. From the point you have promised not to let go, you are in that place. You will be lost. You will come out of it the day you let go. And so if you want to experience liberty and freedom, the true liberty, because most of us have really affected our liberty. We think that we have liberty. We don't have. As much as we think we have. We think that we have freedom. We do not have as much as we think we have. Our liberty and freedom is being hampered, is being affected by the state of our mind, by the things we have promised not to let go. That is a spiritual truth. And so oftentimes, you see that things that are happening ought not to happen. Because the way you see yourself. For these things are happening because you are in spiritual imprisonment. Grace is not flowing the way it ought to flow. Blessings are not flowing the way. Something is obstructing the grace. Something is obstructing the flow of blessings. And what is obstructing is not certain. It's not the death, it's not the enemy. It's those you have planted in your mind not to forgive. Learn how to forgive with the consolation which is what we say we want to let you know, so that when you know this, it will be very easy for you to learn more. The lesson is this. The word of God says that avenge not the evil doer, and that leave vengeance unto me, for I will revenge. And when you read Galatians 6:9, you will hear that God says, "My man, so say shall he also." Now, come back to the lesson on the cross. Come back to the lesson on the cross. Where are Jesus Christ, who was put to that open shame? The Bible says he was put to an open shame. The disgrace they gave him, no mankind has received such disgrace. The torture he went through, the pains. There is nothing anybody will do to the other in the present world that will reflect the kind of pain that was inflicted in Christ. No cost. No matter the pain you claim you have because of someone's action or inaction, you cannot equate the pain you have in your hearts to that of Christ. But remember that Christ taught a lesson. In that state of being, he cried unto the Father, say, have mercy on them, for they know not what they have done. It was a lesson of mercy. Now, the other way, the other side of it, which is not the area we preach regularly, is the area that flashes. The Holy Father said that because of the principle of what you sow, you reap. Because of the principle that God says have said, that even if the heaven and the earth submerge, no sinner will go unpunished. That because of the principle that God has said he will revenge for his children. Even though Christ got that blessing by saying, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they have done, that the Father did not forgive them. And the Father said, that was the reason that up to today and that forever they will continue to suffer it. Because remember that when Pilate, when the wife of Pilate had a dream, when the angels appeared to the wife, you see, this man is an innocent man. He's a child of God. Lest his blood come upon us, remove your hand. Strive to save him. Try to save him. And when Pilate actually tried to save him, and Christ was not willing to go the way Pilate was wanting him to go, because Pilate wanted him to escape. And Christ said, no, I cannot escape. It is written of me, I shall pass through it. I shall test of it. And then Pilate now, because Pilate believed in dream the wife had, as to the calamity that would befall them if they do not set that man free, or Christ, he now called the people and told them, he said something is telling him, and he believed it. That this man is innocent. If we make the mistake and kill him, his blood shall be upon us. And the echo, release him. Release him, we shall kill him. And Pilate said, because I sit on this throne for you, I did not put myself here. It is your wish I will do. But God knows that from today, I wash my hands of this man. I wash my hand. He let his blood not be on my head. Let it not be on me. I wash my hand. For I desire to save him. people say, let his blood be upon us and our children children. That was said at the time of fire. And so ordinarily, that merciful statement, that appeal, which was made after the people echoed and said, let his blood be upon them. He was on the cross when he was to die. He said, forgive them. So the forgiveness was supposed to cover even that statement, let his blood be upon us. But the Father said, because God, when he is this, is final. Whatsoever thing you should say shall do me, your sin shall find you, he shall locate you. At the appropriate time, he shall find you. If you are walking today free, do not think that God has forgiven you. Do not think that you are free from this. You can never be free from it until you pay the price. And if you don't pay it in this time, when you come back again, you pay it. That is for every man to be careful. Every man to be careful. It is not an easy thing. It is not as simple as you think it. That Christ cried on the cross. He said, Father, forgive them. It is a statement well known by all Christians. Forgive them, for they know not. But they were not forgiven. And that is why there have been no peace for over 2,300 years that Christ left, that Christ was persecuted. Israel has not seen peace. They have not seen peace. War or war. Today, if you look as if there is peace, the next day is war. They are killing. No rest. No rest. And so, beloved Christian brethren, the bottom line to name it is that those that persecuted Christ were not free from it. And those who will persecute you shall not be free from it.
Amen.
Those who shall be a thorn on your flesh shall not be free from it.
Amen.
Those whose hands are in someone else's blood shall not be free from their blood.
Amen.
This is the truth about the nature of God. But like I said, it is not the kind of gospel that we preach regularly. Because if you stretch it, it will look as if there is actually nothing like forgiveness. So if you stretch it, you cause fear, and someone will say, ah, if it is so, then why, I mean, let me not go ahead. So we do not intend to pray such an answer, but know the offer, know the truth, and be careful. Read the Golden Text. Have you read the Golden Text? Let go. Since you have known that that person who have really offended you, who have wronged you, will have their father to contend with. It is not for you to handle the person. It is not for you to reward the person. It is not for you to pay back. If you can, which is what you have to do, is I have forgiven you. I pray the Father to have mercy on you. My brother. My master. Yes! Remove your hand from people. Leave people. Leave people alone. Leave people alone. None of us is greater than Christ. There is no prayer that as I am, I will pray that you will be more greater than Christ's prayer. There is no prayer as you have that you will pray that you will be more potent than the prayer of Christ. If Christ prayed, that Father forgive them, have mercy on them, for they know no more. But he tried to exonerate them. He tried to create a conscious mind in the Father that they acted in ignorance. And that one who is ignorant should not be punished. And the Father said, that's what I have done. I will punish them. And up till now, he is still punishing them. So man has to be afraid. Man has to be afraid. Let us fear God. So free yourself, don't put yourself in imprisonment. When they come looking for your trouble, don't worry. Even if what they have done, you have suffered from it, or you are suffering from it, never mind. Free yourself. You are only free yourself. Say, I don't have anything against you. I don't like what you have done to us. I don't have anything against you. I pray the Father to have mercy on you. For me, I have forgiven you. Move on. Don't look back. Okay. Yes. When Christ prayed that the Father should forgive them, he left. Has he looked back? All the man has been now that they are suffering. As Christ prayed again, he said it's enough. If you don't want to be, yeah, finish. They are not hearing you.
Knowing this that our old man is crucified with me, that the body of sin may be destroyed, that it means that we should not crucify sin. For me, that is dead from sin, is free from sin. Now, if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. Knowing that Christ is very rich and the dead, there is no more death and no more pain in my life.
Amen. Love is and reverence for your reference. Go and read Romans 6 verse 4. For your reverence also, read Romans 8 verse 11. At this point in time, we shall say, the ultimate is that the end of this gospel has come. He spoke of the game sufficient.